We ask a lot of questions about our diet. What's the right way to treat a chronic illness, fight off a virus, lose weight? The problem is we get a lot of different answers. Well, I'm here to help. Welcome to the Nutrition Facts Podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Greger. Let's see if you know more about basic nutrition than most doctors. Here's our first story.
A poor diet now outranks smoking as the leading cause of death on the planet, as well as specifically in the United States. In the U.S., the number one killer of Americans is the American diet. So if diet is humanity's number one killer, then obviously it's the number one thing taught in medical school, right? Sadly, medical students around the world are poorly trained in nutrition. It's not that medical students aren't interested in learning about it. Medical schools just aren't teaching it. Without a solid foundation of clinical nutrition knowledge and skills, physicians worldwide are generally not equipped to even begin to have an informed conversation about nutrition with their patients. How bad is it? One study assessing the clinical nutrition knowledge of medical doctors found the majority got 70% of the questions wrong. And there were multiple-choice questions, so they should have gotten about a fifth right just by chance. And the wrong answers were not limited to difficult or demanding questions. For example, less than half could guess how many calories are in fat, carbs, and protein. Only 1 in 10 knew the recommended protein intake, and only about 1 in 3 knew what a healthy BMI was. I mean, this is like super basic nutrition knowledge. And what's worse, not only did the majority of medical doctors get a failing grade, but 30% of those who failed had a high self-perception of their clinical nutrition expertise, meaning not only were they clueless about nutrition, they were also clueless that they were clueless about nutrition, a particularly bad combination, given that doctors are trusted and influential sources of healthy eating advice. For those majority of consumers who get information from their personal healthcare professional, 78% indicate making a change in their eating habits as a result of those conversations. So if everything the doctor knows they read in some checkout aisle magazine, that's what the patients are going to be following. Only a quarter of doctors surveyed correctly identified the American Heart Association's recommended number of fruit and vegetable servings per day, and fewer still were aware of the recommended daily added sugar limits. So how are they going to counsel patients on it? Yet again, of the doctors who perceive themselves as having high nutrition knowledge, 93% couldn't answer those two basic multiple-choice questions. Physicians with no genuine expertise in, say, brain surgery are neither likely to broadcast detailed opinions on that topic, nor have their quote-unquote expert opinions solicited by media. And most topical domains in medicine enjoy such respect. We defer expert opinion and commentary to actual experts. Not so with nutrition, where the common knowledge that physicians are generally ill-trained in this area is conjoined to routine invitations to physicians for their expert opinions on the matter. All too many are willing to provide their opinions absent any basis for actual expertise, or worse, made on the basis of bias and personal preference, sometimes directly tethered to personal gain, such as diet book sales. That's one of the reasons all the proceeds I receive from my books are donated directly to charity. I don't even want the appearance of any conflicts of interest. In a culture that routinely fails to distinguish expertise from mere opinion or personal anecdote, we physicians should be doing all we can to establish relevant barriers to entry for expert opinion on diet and nutrition, as in all other matters of genuine medical significance. I mean, we're not talking celebrity gossip. Lives are at stake, and there are entire industries devoted to marketing messages that may conspire directly against well-informed medical advice in this area. Medical education must be brought up to date. For physicians to be ill-trained in the very area most impactful on the rate of premature death at the population level is an absurd anachronism. The mission of medicine is to protect, defend, and advance the human condition. That mission cannot be fulfilled if diet is neglected. Maybe one place to start is for physicians and healthcare organizations to collectively begin to emphasize their seriousness about nutrition and healthcare by practicing what they at least should be preaching. Is it appropriate to serve pizza and soft drinks at a resident conference while bemoaning the high prevalence of obesity and encouraging patients to eat healthier? A similarly poor example exists in medical conferences, including national meetings where some morning sessions are accompanied by foods such as donuts and sausage. About a decade ago, the American Heart Association expressed concern that their 2020 target of improving cardiovascular health by 20% by 2020 would not be reached if current trends continued. By 2006, most people were already not smoking and had nearly achieved their goal for exercise. But when it came to healthy diet score, only about 1% got a 4 or 5 out of their 0 to 5 diet quality score, and that's with so-called ideal criteria being like drinking less than 4.5 cups of soda a week. In the last decade, they saw a bump up to like 1% of Americans even reaching this kind of basic criteria. But given their aggressive goal of improving that by 20% by 2020, they hope to turn that 1% into like 1.2%. OK, so how'd we do? Let's look at the 2019 update, and it looks like we've slipped down to as low as 1 in 1,000, and American teens got a big fat zero. No wonder, perhaps, that for all mortality-based metrics, the U.S. rank declined like 27th or 28th among 34 industrialized countries. Citizens living in countries with a substantially lower GDP and health expenditures per capita have lower mortality rates than those in the United States. Slovenia beat us by 3 countries, coming in at 24th in life expectancy to our 27th. And more recently, we seem to have slipped to 43rd, even though we spent trillions on healthcare more than anyone else. What's the leading risk factor for death in the United States? What we eat. The standard American diet is just to die for, literally. Those trillions in healthcare spending aren't addressing the root cause. Approximately 80% of chronic disease and premature death could be prevented by not smoking, being physically active, and adhering to a healthful dietary pattern. But what exactly is meant by a healthy diet? Unfortunately, what we hear about nutrition in the media is often inconsistent and confusing. There's a pressure within today's competitive journalism market for sensationalism. There may even be a disincentive to present the facts in context to sell more magazines. In fact, about 3/4 of a century ago, it was noted that, unfortunately, the subject of nutrition seems to have a special appeal to the credulous, the social zealot, and, in the commercial field, the unscrupulous, a combination calculated to strike despair in the hearts of the sober, objective scientist. The most important healthcare problem we face may be our poor lifestyle choices based on misinformation. It's like the climate change deniers. Healthy dietary advice is overshadowed by critics, diet books, industry interests, and misguided information in the media. Maybe what we need is like an IPCC of nutrition. These days, no single expert, regardless of academic stature or reputation, has the prominence to overcome the obstacles created by confusing media messages and effectively deliver the fundamental principles of healthy living to the public. However, what if there was a global coalition consisting of a variety of nutrition experts who collectively represent the views held by the majority of scientists, physicians, and health practitioners? It could serve as a guiding resource of sound nutrition information for improved health and prevention of disease. Boom! The True Health Initiative was conceived for that very purpose. A nonprofit coalition of hundreds of experts from dozens of countries agreeing to a consensus statement on the fundamentals of healthy living. Check out www.truehealthinitiative.org. Spoiler alert, the healthiest diet is one generally comprised mostly of minimally processed plants. We would love it if you could share with us your stories about reinventing your health through evidence-based nutrition. Go to nutritionfacts.org/testimonials. We may be able to share it on social media to help inspire others.
If you hear about any graphs, charts, graphics, images, or studies mentioned here, please go to the Nutrition Facts Podcast landing page. There you'll find all the detailed information you need, plus links to all the sources we cite for each of these topics. My latest major book, How Not to Age, is out. Check it out from your local public library. Also wrote like a mini book on Ozempic, available in softcover, ebook, and audio versions. Check it out on nutritionfacts.org. And of course, all the proceeds I receive from the sales of all my books goes directly to charity. Nutritionfacts.org is a nonprofit, science-based public service where you can sign up for free daily updates on the latest nutrition research with bite-sized videos and articles. Everything on the website is free. There are no ads, no corporate sponsorships, no kickbacks, strictly non-commercial. I'm not selling anything. I just put it up as a public service, as a labor of love, as a tribute to my grandmother, whose own life was saved with evidence-based nutrition.